One of the most universal questions asked wherever you go is some variation of what's my calling? How do I find my purpose? How do I find where I fit my role? Now, the good news is you're asking the right question. And today, we're going to look at a story that I think perfectly epitomizes finding your calling. What's your calling? It's a fantastic question. And the reason is God created you and I at our root to have purpose, a role to play in His kingdom. Now, unfortunately, most people pursue success, fame, wealth, rather than purpose. And those things might be exciting for a time, but that's why they don't bring fulfillment, because it's not what you were created for. But I really believe once you find your purpose and you're operating in that, if God gives you these other things, then they're less of a distraction. Why? Because you're finding your fulfillment in serving Him in that unique way. And it is unique. Before we get into the story, there's four key takeaways that I believe if you will use as a template, as a roadmap, will absolutely lead you to that unique thing He has for you. But before we do, there's two things I want to point out that don't work. First off, it is unique. God doesn't do cookie cutter. He created you and I uniquely, and that purpose is absolutely unique. So that means we can't look at someone else and copy, emulate what they're doing, because God doesn't do cookie cutter. Now, we might learn from them. We might be stretched and challenged by them, but we're not to emulate them, even if they're in the same vein we are, because again, God is doing something unique in your life. Number two, the other side is we have this expectation that, God, I'm doing this for you, so if I just ask, God is going to give you the answer. And it seems like the sooner we know it, the less time is wasted. God, I can be serving you more fully right now if I know what that is. But what we'll see is God works through a process, and that process continual for the rest of our lives. And so what happens is the longer we delay integrating into that process, the longer we wait because we're looking for that answer, the more delay there is us getting that increasing revelation of what He's called you and I to. So we're going to look in this story, and you can follow along. It's in 1 Samuel chapter 3. Before we do, kind of so we understand, Samuel at this point is a really young man. I don't know an exact age. He's anything from a child to a very young man. And Samuel is a miracle. It's a great story in chapters 1 and 2, if you want to go back and look at it, where his mother was unable to have children. And a beautiful story where she's calling out to, in her grief, calling out to God. She's not even speaking words. Her lips are moving. In fact, the priest thinks she must be drunk. But God answers her prayer, and Samuel is the response. And she dedicates Samuel to the Lord. Now, on a side note, Samuel would go on to be an unbelievably amazing man of God. And he was, for his generation, the leader that God chose for his people. So when we look at the story of Samuel starting to understand what he's called to, we have to understand this was just the beginning of this amazing thing that God was going to do through Samuel. And the good news is for you and I, regardless of your age, whether you're a young warrior or whether you're older, as we more fully begin to understand our calling, our purpose, and we operate in that, God is glorified. And we are on this exciting adventure that is more fulfilling than anything else. All those other things, they're byproducts. So we pick the story up in chapter 3. Now, what do we see? So Samuel, because he's dedicated to the Lord, he lives in the tabernacle, the sanctuary where the Ark of the Covenant was. And that Ark of the Covenant represented God's presence to his people. And he was there serving Eli, who was the priest. Now, coming back to that, those are the first two attributes we absolutely need to understand as part of the process. The first two takeaways. Number one, he was continually in God's presence. If we want to find our calling, find our purpose, it's not going to come from us in an isolated manner out doing our own thing. We must not just be in God's presence, but we need to, for the rest of our life, as much as possible, be in God's presence for us to continue. See, it's not a one-time thing, for us to continue to grow in all that He has for us. You know, a side note, Joshua, who was in another amazing man of God, he was one of the greatest military leaders of all time. But long before he was that, see, Moses would go to the tent of meeting, the sanctuary, where the ark was, and he would meet with God face to face. And then Moses would take that and go out and share with the people what God was saying. But it says that, but Joshua stayed. See, he stayed in that place where God was. And later, God developed him into what probably the greatest military leader of all time. So back to Samuel. He not only lives in the sanctuary, but he slept in the room with the Ark of the Covenant. He stayed in God's presence. And that's the most critical aspect. If we will do that, as we'll see in a moment, it's not about us figuring it out, learning what we, but it's about us being in that place where God can speak to us and work through us. Number two, and this is a principle I share so often because it just runs counter. Everybody wants to be independent. They want their own thing. But a critical understanding here is, what was Samuel doing there in the tabernacle? He was serving God by being a servant to Eli. He was serving God by being faithful, serving someone else. See, one of the things that we need to understand is our purpose, our calling is revealed as we prove faithful. See, the word says that when we're faithful with a little, then we'll be put in charge of much. Before we can receive our own, we've got to be faithful serving someone else's ministry, someone else's calling, someone else's purpose. So number one, being in God's presence continually. Number two, being faithful to serve wherever we can. He was a servant. This is not glamorous. Whether we're cleaning the sanctuary, whatever, as we're being faithful to serve, then God can say, well done. And when we're faithful to that little thing, He can give us greater. Now, here's where it gets really good. So it's night. Samuel's not quite asleep, but what is it? The Lord starts calling him. Now, this is where it's really good for you and I, because the Lord calls him repeatedly. And each time, see, it goes on and says, because Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor had the word of the Lord been revealed to him. See, he was in God's presence. He was serving. He was doing everything right, but he didn't have an understanding of God. How does that relate to you and I? Well, here's the thing. We may have a relationship with God, but there is continually deeper. There's so much more we don't know yet. But here's the beauty of this. Samuel did not have to figure it out. He didn't have to work it out. He didn't have to learn it. What did he do? Because he was faithful doing those two things. He was faithful serving Eli, and he was in God's presence continually. God initiated, and that's the way God works. He wants to initiate with you and I when we are doing those things. And not only did he initiate, but he repeatedly, he was consistently coming to Samuel until Samuel understood. So we see that he calls Samuel several times, and Samuel thinks it's Eli. Finally, Eli says to him, because again, what did it say? He did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. But Eli realizes something and finally says to him, say, Lord, your servant listens, speak. So what does he do? He responds. But the important part of this story is God was the one that not only was initiating, but God was the one that was going to continue until Samuel realized it was him. Now, as he did so, God spoke to him and he told him something very specific. Now, so first off, we need to be in God's presence. We have to be faithful serving others. We need to realize as we do that, allow God to initiate. Don't try to create something ourselves, because that never really works out. But the fourth thing is this. As God begins, and it's just a first step, as God begins to reveal, then we have to be faithful and responsible with what He's given us. Now, in Samuel's case, unfortunately, it was a very hard word. Eli's sons had not spoken well of God, and there was, unfortunately, a judgment coming. So the next morning when Eli asked what God had shown him, he had to be faithful to bring that message, no matter how difficult it was. Now, for you and I, I'm not saying it has to be difficult, but what we must do is, when God begins to reveal His calling, His purpose, and He shows us what to do, recognize that's just a first step, and we must be faithful and respond to that first step. Now, later on, there's this great verse where it talks about how not only was God with Samuel, but He made sure that everything that Samuel said came to pass, so that the people all knew that He was with Samuel. But all of that started way back by the four attributes. One, being continually in God's presence. Number two, being faithful to serve someone else, even if it's not glamorous, even if it doesn't seem like it's helping us get to our calling. Number three, allowing God to initiate. And number four, responding when God showed him that first step. So I look forward to hearing from you guys. You can, in the app, you can hit the message and you can send replies. I truly believe if you will allow this process to work in your life, regardless of age, even if you have your calling, even if you have a sense of your calling, we must continually let God take us further. And I believe this is the roadmap to do so.